B. Sullenberger. The 155 people whom he saved or rescued know his name. On January 15, 2009, U.S. Airways Flight 1549 began on a routine journey that ended in anything but. Shortly after taking off from the New York airport, LaGuardia, this particular flight, as it was climbing, hit a flock of birds that took out both of its engines. There were 155 people on board that plane. Rather than panicking, the pilot, Sullenberger, decided that he was going to land in the Hudson River so that he could avoid the densely populated city of New York. Amazingly, no one was killed. Everyone survived. After they landed into the Hudson, police boats, ferry boats came in on the plane and rescued all of the people. It's particularly cold, 35-degree water, 18-degree temperature. What could have ended in a disaster ended up in one of the greatest stories of heroism and rescue ever. Sullenberger rescued all of those people by his actions, by his decision to land in the Hudson River, in what was known, or has come to be known, as the Hudson Miracle. You've heard of it, right? Even made a movie about it, right? Where Tom Hanks plays Sullenberger about this story. We love stories like this, don't we? We love stories when someone steps out, takes action, makes a decision, and people are rescued and are saved by that person's actions. We should like those stories. And we should give those heroes honor like Sullenberger. However, his story, like many others like it, pale in comparison to what I would say is the greatest rescue story in all of history. And I'm speaking about when God, through his Son, rescued his people for himself, a rescue that they could not do, that we could not do for ourselves, but only could be accomplished through our King, the Lord Jesus. So that's what we're going to be looking at today. We're going to be looking at Colossians chapter 1, and the title of our message this morning is Rescued. We're going to be looking at verses 13 through 14. If you want, and if you have any questions about today's message, you can text that in. I'll do my best to answer those at the end. We'll put those on the screen. But this morning, as we look at verses 13 through 14, we're going to unpack what this rescue was all about and how it still impacts us and will impact us for the rest of our lives or existence. Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 through 14. Here's what Paul wrote to the Colossian church. For he, that is God the Father, rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. These two verses are connected to Paul's prayer that we've been going through the last few weeks, where Paul thanked God, right, for what he did in these people's lives, having saved them from their sin. Last week we looked at, as Paul continued his prayer for these people, when he says, we pray that you would know God's will for your life, that you would obey God's will for your life in God's power, right? That's what we looked at last week. Here, he is continuing, and because of that, we should be thankful, we should be grateful for what God has done. And here he's giving more reasons to be thankful, or maybe the primary reason to be thankful for what God has done, right? Qualified us to have or gain the inheritance of the saints in the light. And here he continues that thought, for he rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his Son. So it's in that thought that we read these two verses. But these two verses are very packed with meaning and have a great immense impact on who we are in Christ. So we're just going to handle these two verses and what it means to be transferred from the domain of darkness into the kingdom of His Son. What does it mean? And what does it mean to us today? And the first thing we're going to talk about is, why was this rescue needed? Why did we have to be rescued? Why? What's the reason for our rescue, as we see introduced in the beginning of verse 13? He, that's God the Father, rescued us from the domain of darkness. What's the reason for that? Why did He have to do that? Well, as you know, to be rescued means that you have a need, right? That you are either in a situation that, or even with someone else, and that you need help. And it means that someone needs to help you. And in the context, it was those who put their faith in Jesus, the Christ, the Son of God, right? Christians, believers, disciples, followers of Jesus, those of us who have done that, He's referring to how we needed to be rescued. And He means everyone who has placed their faith in Christ, because as you notice, Paul has transitioned from just praying about them and what God did for them, he includes himself. He says He's done this for us, right? And the one doing the rescuing is God the Father, as we see in verse 12. Now, the reason for the rescue is found in the phrase, the domain of darkness, which is chocked full and pregnant with meaning. We won't address it all today, but we'll try to unpack some of it, right? The term domain simply means either authority or tyranny at times, or kingdom. So in reality, the phrase, the kingdom of darkness, is very appropriate. Very appropriate. There are several places in the Bible that refer to this contrast between light and darkness. This is one of those passages where light is seen that which is righteous, that which is godly, and darkness is seen as unrighteousness or ungodliness, right? But here, he's not just talking about ungodliness and godliness. Here, he's actually talking about the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of ungodliness. This kingdom is what we needed to be rescued from. When Paul is saved, if you remember in the book of Acts, by Jesus on the road to Damascus, Jesus said this to Paul. He says, I am going to save you, and I'm going to use you to tell others about me. And this is why. This is what Jesus said. He said, to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness, get this, to light. Another one of those passages. But Jesus goes on to tell Paul this, and from, get this, the dominion of Satan to God. Same phrase there. From the dominion of the enemy, Satan, to God, that they may receive the forgiveness of sins and the inheritance among the saints, or those who have been sanctified by faith in me. So it's the kingdom of darkness is really the kingdom of Satan, where he has power. He is our enemy. And being that it is his kingdom and he is king over that kingdom, it means that that kingdom once had authority or power over us. It once kept us in darkness. So what is that power? What does it mean? How were we once under its influence? How are those who are still under its influence? How are they affected? How are we affected? Well, in the first three chapters of the Bible, in chapter 3 particularly, we learn that all of humanity falls into sin. We call that the fall. Right? The fall of humanity. Everyone in Adam and Eve, when they chose to disobey God, to disobey His word, to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, all of humanity in Adam and Eve fell into sin. Right? All of us were affected by sin because of their choice. Everyone that has ever existed has been affected by Adam and Eve and their choice to disobey God, and the rest of humanity, except for Jesus, has been affected by their sin. By the way, I don't know if you knew this. You ever heard of the Genome Project or the research that they've done on genetics and the report that came out in 1987? Right, where they where they mapped out human DNA. Did you know that they discovered that all of humanity have come from two people, a male and a female? Did you know that? Geneticists don't dispute that. Now, they wouldn't admit that it was the biblical Adam and Eve, but science tells us we all came from two people. And these two people affected all of us when they chose to disobey God. Listen to this. This is Romans chapter 5, verse 12, speaking of that. It says, therefore, just as through one man sin entered into the world, and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned. Right? Paul's talking about this. This sin impacted the entire human race. This is why we say things like we were born in sin, or that we have, all of us, a sin nature. We are sinners not just because we sin, but because we are born sinners. We are born with that nature. We have been affected by that. All you have to do is look at a two-year-old and see how self-centered they are, right? How self-driven they are, how easily rebellious they are to see this, right? They don't need to be taught to act that way, to respond that way. They just are that way from infancy. Why? It's because they've been affected by Adam and Eve's sin. We all are. They're unable to do anything about it, as we all are unable to do anything about it. Now, you might think, well, you can learn to not be that way, not to be selfish. You can learn not to sin, right, and do what's right and be righteous. I mean, children can learn. People can learn. However, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, rather, even the good things we do are wickedness, apart from being transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his Son. Isaiah 64:6 says this, for all of us, notice how inclusive that statement is, all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy garment. All our righteous deeds, all our good things that we do are a filthy garment, literally soiled menstrual rags. Pretty disgusting, isn't it? That's the point. That's the point. Remember, God doesn't grade on a scale, right? Remember when your teacher used to say, hey, we have a quiz next week, and we're going to grade on a scale, and the average, that's what everybody's going to get. God doesn't do that. God's perfect. He's holy. He's righteous, right? There's nothing he does that is wicked or evil. He is light, and he grades on that scale. And anything less than that scale is like a filthy rag, is what he says. This is what's known as the depravity of humanity, right? This is, or what the reformers call total depravity, meaning sin has affected the totality of our being. Everything we do, everything we think, our thoughts and our actions is affected by sin, and we are depraved. Humanity, being in this state, unable to do anything about it, was not only helpless, but hopeless. You can't understand the truth. You can't understand the scripture. You can't understand the gospel. You can't know who God is. And this is the power that Satan, the king of the kingdom of darkness, had over us and still has over those who are still in darkness. He blinds us to the truth and to believe his lies. 2 Corinthians says this, verse 4, chapter 4, 4. In whose case the god of this world, that is Satan, blinded the minds of the unbelieving, so that they might not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. That's what Satan does. And that's who we once were, and that's who those who don't believe in Jesus, that's the way they still are. They believe the lies of the enemy, of Satan, the devil. They cannot understand that God is who he is, as he says in Scripture. They don't understand the gospel. They believe the lie that fulfilling their sinful appetites and desires, they believe that it will fulfill them. There is no hope for them. They are helpless. There's no way to overcome this situation. This is why the rescue was needed. This is why it affects everyone. Romans 3 says, there is none righteous, no, not even one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become useless. There is none who does good. There is not even one. Why? For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. This is why the rescue was needed. This is why The tyranny of Satan had to be broken, and the only one who could break his tyranny is God himself. And Paul is saying this is what God did through Christ. This is who we were. This is how we were before God transferred us into the kingdom of his Son. If you are in Christ, if you follow Christ, if he is your king, if he is your master, you now are no longer under the domain of darkness. You are no longer subject to the enemy. He no longer has power over you. Indeed, he has power, but not over you anymore. You now know the truth. All he can do now is tempt you. All he can do is entice you to submit to his power. This is why Paul says he's thankful. This is why we should be thankful. This is why we now can not only know God's will, seek it out, obey it in his power, is because God has given us a kingdom and has granted us entrance into this kingdom. And we now can follow his will, obey his will, as we learn from his word in the power that he has given to us in the Holy Spirit. This also informs us as to how we should relate to the world, if you think about it. How we should relate to those who are in darkness. It's easy for us to forget that everyone who does not know God through Christ is in darkness. We forget, why do people act that way? Why do people say things like that? Why do they think that way? It's because they are in darkness, as we once were. They are under the power and the dominion of Satan. This is why they reject the truth. This is why they believe such ludicrous theories and lies that we came from nothing. I mean, you ever stop and think about that we came from nothing? That's what they say. It's ludicrous. That's the devil. They continue in sin. They cannot stop. True. Some are worse than others, but all are unredeemed, all are in darkness. And Paul says this of who we once used to be. He says, do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And then he says this most fascinating statement, and such were some of you. That's who you used to be. That's who you were when you were in darkness. That's how blinded you were. That was the power you lived under. And such were some of you, however, but you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Spirit of our God. This should remind us that those who are in darkness, that we were just like them and we are no better, and that should create in us humility. We're no better. We should never think ourselves better. We should pity them. We should have mercy on them. That should motivate us to tell them how to be rescued from the darkness, how to be delivered, how to be transferred. The fact that we've been transferred from the kingdom of his beloved Son, or from darkness into the kingdom of his beloved Son, means that we should tell others about it, right? We should help them address their sin. We should inform them what the darkness is, right? Have you ever heard the phrase, love the sinner, hate the sin? You ever heard that, right? And there's truth to that statement, right? Don't approve sinful behavior. We love people, though. However, a lot of times, because of what that sentiment, we would say, well, because we love the sinner, we're not going to tell them about their sin because that's unloving. They might be offended by that. So we remain silent. However, think about it. If there is a person whom you love and care for and you hate sin and you know how destructive it is, why would you stay silent on something that is destructive to them? Why would you do that? If you love them, you would tell them about it. In humility, remembering you and I, those who have placed their faith in Jesus, are the same apart from Christ. But nevertheless, in truth and humility, bringing them the truth of their sin so that they too can be rescued by Christ, and pointing them to him as their only hope, from the domain of darkness. This is why we needed to be rescued. That's who we were. But we're no longer that, are we? We are no longer under that domain or that power of Satan that he wielded against us. We are no longer in his kingdom. We are in the kingdom of God's own Son. We were helplessly bound, but now we have been freed. We have been rescued. So what does that mean? We'll explore more of what that means to be in the kingdom of his Son as we look at the impact of our rescue. Basically, how should we then now live? We who have been transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son. You know, one of the spoils of a conquering nation who's conquered another, one of the spoils in the ancient world, and today, even in the modern world, this happens, one of the spoils is that you have the freedom and the ability to transplant a people to another place. I don't want you living in your homeland anymore. I'm going to take you somewhere else. This happened to the northern kingdom of Israel when Assyria conquered Israel. We'll see this in 2 Kings when we reach it in the fall. The king of Assyria took all the Israelites and he transplanted them to Assyria. You can do that when you conquer a people. More recently, in the 1930s, the Soviet Union did this to the Korean population that lived in eastern Russia. They took about, I think it was about 150,000 Koreans and transferred them to the countries of Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan. Here is a description of those who have placed their faith in Christ and how the King, King Jesus, transferred us from that kingdom into his own kingdom. That's the picture. That's what's going on. Now, we have been transferred. Now we're in this kingdom, right? Here it speaks of the kingdom of his beloved Son. Other scriptures talk about the kingdom of God or of Christ or of heaven. They all refer to the same kingdom, right? There are those who would believe, and it's very confusing when you read them, that, oh, when it's kingdom of heaven or kingdom of Christ, those are different. And the kingdom of the Father, they're all the same, okay? They're all the same. Now, they are all the same, but they do sometimes refer to different aspects of that kingdom, right? There are two aspects primarily that the Bible talks about that you need to know. What does it mean by kingdom? What does it mean now? What does it mean then? Right? What is the present aspect and what is the future aspect? Right? The present aspect, I believe, is in view here in our passage today. It's like when Jesus said, pray this, or do this. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and these things will be added to you today. The implication is that you can experience and seek out the kingdom, and it can be found here and now. We're in it now. We can live within it now. We can submit to it now. However, there are those other passages that speak of something that's still yet future. Right before Paul is about to die, as he's imprisoned in 2 Timothy, he says this, the Lord will rescue me from every evil deed, listen to this, and will bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. So even though Paul was in the kingdom, had been transferred into it, he is still awaiting a future kingdom. See what I mean? Right? This is why in Matthew 6, when the disciples' prayer, we pray, your kingdom come. So there's a future aspect to it as well. So we use terms like this. The kingdom of Christ, of his Son, of God, of heaven is already, right, we're in it now, but not yet. There still remains future aspect of this kingdom. Now let's talk about, okay, what does it mean to live in this kingdom now? And then in a bit we'll talk about what it means then or in the future. Being in the kingdom now means that we now, as we have spoken about, have been freed from the kingdom of Satan. And because we've been freed from the kingdom of Satan, we are freed from his power and his dominion, and we've been freed from the penalty of sin, which is judgment, right? We have been freed from the penalty of sin. It's been removed. We no longer bear that weight. We no longer bear that guilt. Why? Because Christ the King has taken it for us on the cross. We have also been freed from the power of sin in our lives. The power of sin has been weakened and thwarted, and we no longer have to live under its power. Why? Because we're no longer in the kingdom of darkness, in the kingdom of Satan. Everything we did prior to knowing Christ, prior to coming to know Him through faith, trusting in Him alone, was tainted by sin. All of it. But now, in Christ, we can resist sin and actually live righteously. Not perfectly, but righteously. I mean, this is why Paul says, at the end of the Ephesian letter, he says, finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and the strength of His might. Right? Giving us a clue. This is how you can resist the devil. Be strong in the Lord and the strength of His might. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against who? Against the schemes of the devil, Satan. The implication is that you now have the ability and the power to resist our old king, Satan, the devil. We who were once blinded by him now know the truth. We can resist him and we can know the truth, and we no longer have to give in to his lies. 1 John talks about how we have an anointing from the Holy One, and I believe he's speaking about the Holy Spirit, and you all know. I have written to you because you know the truth, and you know what lies are. The life we now live can be lived in obedience to our King, Jesus, in righteousness. We don't have to be subject to Satan's power anymore. We can truly obey Christ now, in the kingdom now. Romans 14:17, for the kingdom of God, this is that present aspect, how we live it now, the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. That's how we live now. In obedience to our King, we are subject to Him. He now rules over us through His Word as we obey it in the power of His Spirit that He's given to us. That's how we live now. That's what we've been freed to do. We've been freed from sin and its power over us. There's also the future aspect that I've referenced. This future kingdom when Christ will come and live among us. This promise of Jesus' presence among us, where there will be no more sin and only the redeemed will inherit it. When John has a vision of this, right? He describes it in one of the most beautiful passages, I believe, in all of the Scripture. Those of us who experience the power of sin and the destructiveness of sin and how it just desecrates our lives, when we read these words of where we're going, it is like a balm to our soul. Listen to this. This is Revelation chapter 21. John writes, verse 1, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth have passed away. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the tabernacle, the dwelling of God, is among men, and He will dwell among them, and they shall be His people, and God Himself will be among them. And listen to this. And He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain, for the first things have passed away. That is the future kingdom. Because we have been transferred from the domain of Satan, that is what awaits us who have placed our faith in Jesus. That is what we have been rescued for. That is the future of all those who have placed their faith in Christ and in Him alone for the redemption of their souls. Look at that last phrase, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. There's a powerful word picture here. When Paul talks of being purchased, right? He uses this phrase that you've been bought with a price. There's a specific word that just means to purchase. You go to a marketplace and you purchase something. This word for redemption means more than that. This particular word that Paul uses here actually refers to the price one would have to pay if they were a slave for their own freedom. The purchase price, the redemptive price. One of the darkest, most tragic times in our own nation's history is when it was legal to own another human being. What we know as the institution of slavery. And you know, the predominant race that was enslaved were blacks or African Americans. These people who are no less created in the image of God as any of us were owned, stolen from their homeland, forced to live in subjection to other people. This form of slavery that existed in our country was known as chattel slavery. In other words, the slaves were seen as mere property to be exploited, to be ruled. They had no rights. They had no power to free themselves. Their children were born into this slavery. The only freedom that they could gain is if their owner let them free, which rarely ever happened. They could be sold at any time. They were helpless. They were hopeless. They had no power to change their own standing. And what Paul is saying here is that's who we were under the kingdom of darkness. We were slaves. We were hopeless. We were helpless. We were subject to. We couldn't change it. Everyone was born into it. No one could change it. But Christ has come and he has redeemed us to himself. We have been purchased by his blood on the cross. We who were in darkness, we who had no power, have been redeemed from sin and its effects in our lives. He has purchased us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. Amen? So how do we now live? Okay, that's great. What difference does that make? What should be our response to this? What should be our response to the fact that you and I who have placed our faith in Jesus, what should be our response to that truth that we no longer are under Satan's power? That we are in the kingdom now. That we have a king and we have the ability and the freedom to serve him now. What does that mean right now? And what is the fact that we are promised an eternity with him in his future kingdom? What does that mean right now? How does this flesh itself out? We'll start with this. Simply, if you are in the kingdom, have been redeemed from every lawless deed, no longer live under the power of Satan, we now have the freedom, the privilege of living godly and righteously now. We need to live like we no longer are under the yoke of slavery of sin. We need to follow what God says in his word because of who we are and what he's done for us. We now don't have to give in to Satan's lies. By the way, think about it. Those of us who struggle with fear or worry or anxiety, it's not because of what's true, right? We struggle with those things because the enemy loves to lob lies at us. Actually, the Bible calls them flaming missiles. He loves to create doubt. If you really love God, would you do that? How do you know that this is going to be taken care of? How do you know that this person isn't going to do this? And he loves to lie to us like that. But we who have trusted in Christ can now say, no, I'm not going to subject myself to that yoke of slavery anymore. I've been freed. I am a child of the King. And he tells me that I can trust him. He tells me that he's in control. He tells me that he will provide for me. And I don't have to give in to that temptation. Or the sins that so easily entice us, what we see, we want things people have. We no longer have to live the lie that that is what will satisfy us. We can be content now and stand firm against all the lies of the enemy now. Not because of what we did, but because of what he did. And to live in this power according to his glorious might that we learned about, to know his will, to obey it, according to his glorious might, is not really hard to figure out. I will admit, it's hard to submit to, but it's not that hard to figure out, right? It's like, you know, when you get those, those little kid toys and they got the little shapes and they got little holes. You look at it, you figure it out, and you drop it, right? It's not that hard. You simply walk with God according to his word and relate to him by responding to what he talks to you about in his word through prayer. It's really that simple, and submit to it. That's really what it means. Now, granted, it's not hard to figure out. It's hard to submit to, right? That's why we still struggle. But part of learning how to have victory in the struggle is to remember who we are. We are no longer subject to darkness. We are no longer subject to Satan. We are no longer under his power. We now have the truth. We are in the light. We now can be obedient. And here's, I think, one of the greatest things about obedience. You actually will find contentment. And it's actually better for you. You will actually find joy in obeying God. I mean, God wants that for you. He wants that for us. He wants you to find peace. He wants you to have joy. He wants you to be content. He wants you to be fulfilled. And he tells us this is how you do it. If you're in Christ, you are headed for the future kingdom. What does that mean? How does that impact me now? It means that the way you live this life is you live it in light of the next. And that'll affect what you value, what you pursue, what you cherish, and what you consider as mere tools. These are just things God gives me until I get home. Right? It should revolutionize the way we think of, let's just say, possessions. Right? If it's all going to go away anyway, and we're headed for that heavenly kingdom in the future, and none of this is going to last, that means everything we own, everything that we are, all that we have accomplished, we hold with an open hand. God gave it to me. I'll use it. I'll give it away. I'll use it as long as I am here, but I don't live for that. I don't live for stuff. I don't live for position. I don't live for respect. I live for Christ, my King. And I'm not trying to hoard everything I can in this life because I know I'm headed for a future kingdom. Saving up a nest egg so that you can do anything you want at the end of your life isn't what life is all about. That doesn't mean you shouldn't plan and be wise with what God has given you, but that's not what life's all about. You know when we retire? When we get to the heavenly kingdom that is still future. That's our retirement. Not here. Not here. This should impact the way we view people, right? We talked about, this should impact how we view them. They are still under the domain of darkness. They are not headed for the heavenly kingdom. We should therefore humbly, but kindly and correctly, share with them the news about the King who has come and who can rescue them. True, many of them will not believe, right? Jesus said that. There's a narrow path that leads to life, few who find it. Jesus told us that. But some will. We don't know who they are. So we should speak this to everybody. so that they too would be like us, who have been transferred from the domain and kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his beloved Son. Our rescue from Satan's kingdom and entrance into Christ's kingdom grants us freedom over sin. Period. That's what Paul is saying here. He rescued us, granted us access, entrance. Sin no longer has power. Sin has been thwarted. Again, Satan does have power, just not over us. And we don't have to submit to it anymore. Amen? Joel, did we get any questions today? As the band comes forward, I want to point something out to you as we... We who have been transferred, who have been placed into... I want to unpack something for you that I didn't talk about because it will impact how we view what God did. Do you see the phrase, his beloved son? You see that? This is what the phrase literally means. This is how it was literally written. It kind of sounds awkward in English, but this is what it means. The kingdom of the son of his, that's the father's love. The kingdom of the son of his love. The son who is the object of the father's love. Right? We have one today, right? New parents. When they get that new child, I mean, you're just head over heels over your child, aren't you? Parents, you view your children and they're precious to you, and you gloat over them, and you love them, and you cherish them, and they are objects of your love, right? They're gifts from a good God to you, and you love them. They're precious to you. You value them. So when Paul uses this phrase about the Father, speaking of the Son, saying that the Son is the object of his love, he is saying, he who was most precious and is most precious to him is the one he gave. You see, God didn't just do it whole, half-heartedly or halfway. God gave the best. He gave the one who was most valuable to him, the Lord Jesus. That should conjure up in our mind not only what that statement says, but when you think, you know, a lot of times we focus on Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he's praying, and he's anguished, and he's burdened. He's about to go to the cross because he has never experienced this type of relationship with the Father. The Father is about to unleash all the judgment of sin due us on the Son, and the Son has never endured that. And rightly so, we think about, man, how horrific that must have been for Jesus, and how much he suffered, and how much he endured, and in the anguish that he went through. But think of the anguish of the Father. Could you do that to your child? I couldn't. But God did. That's who we honor and remember when we come around the Lord's table. Father, what can we say or do other than just be thankful that we who were helpless, were in darkness, were hopeless, you have transferred us from that into the kingdom of your Son, that we have been bought off the slave block, that we no longer have to pay for our sins, but that Jesus did it for us. What could we say but thank you? I pray as we remember your Son now, he who has been and still is the object of your love, may we honor him and remember him in a worthy manner. Amen.